I'm going to be reading chapter 10, titled Halloween, from Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Malfoy couldn't believe his eyes when he saw that Harry and Ron were still at Hogwarts next day, looking tired but perfectly cheerful. Indeed, by next morning, Harry and Ron thought that meeting the three-headed dog had been an excellent adventure, and they were quite keen to have another one. In the meantime, Harry filled Ron in about the package that seemed to have been moved from Gringotts to Hogwarts, and they spent a lot of time wondering what could possibly need such heavy protection. It's either really valuable or really dangerous, said Ron. Or both, said Harry. But as all they knew for sure about the mysterious object was that it was about 2 inches long. They didn't have much chance of guessing what it was without further clues. Neither Neville or Hermione showed the slightest interest in what lay underneath the dog and the trapdoor. All Neville cared about was never going near that dog again. Hermione was now refusing to speak to Harry and Ron, but she was such a bossy know-it-all that they saw this as an added bonus. All they really wanted now was a way of getting back at Malfoy. And to their great delight, just such a thing arrived in the post about a week later. As the owls flooded into the great hall as usual, everyone's attention was caught at once by a long, thin package carried by 6 large screech owls. Harry was just as interested as everyone else to see what was in the large parcel, and was amazed when the owl soared down and dropped it right in front of him, knocking his bacon to the floor. They had hardly fluttered out of the way when another owl dropped a letter on top of the parcel. Harry ripped open the letter first, which was lucky because it said, "Do not open the parcel at the table. It contains your new Nimbus 2000. But I don't want everybody knowing you've got a broomstick or they'll all want one. Oliver Wood will meet you tonight on the Quidditch pitch at 7 o'clock for your first training session, Professor McGonagall." Harry had difficulty hiding his glee as he handed the note to Ron to read. "A Nimbus 2000? Ron moaned enviously. "I've never even touched one." They left the hall quickly, wanting to unwrap the broomstick in private before their first lesson. But halfway across the entrance hall, they found the way upstairs barred by Crabbe and Goyle. Malfoy seized the package from Harry and felt it. "That's a broomstick," he said, throwing it back at Harry with a mixture of jealousy and spite on his face. "You'll be for it this time, Potter. First years aren't allowed them." Ron couldn't resist. "It's not any old broomstick," he said. "It's a Nimbus 2000. "What do you say you got at home, Malfoy? A Comet 260? Ron grinned at Harry. "Comets look flashy, but they're not in the same league as the Nimbus. "What would you know about it, Weasley? You couldn't afford half the handle," Malfoy snapped back. "I suppose you and your brothers have to save up twig by twig." Before Ron could answer, Professor Flitwick appeared at Malfoy's elbow. "Not arguing, I hope, boys," he squeaked. "Potter's been sent a broomstick, Professor," said Malfoy quickly. "Yes, yes, that's right," said Professor Flitwick, beaming at Harry. "Professor McGonagall told me about the special circumstances. Potter, what model is it?" "A Nimbus 2000, sir," said Harry, fighting to not laugh at the look of horror on Malfoy's face. "And it's really thanks to Malfoy here that I've got it," he added. Harry and Ron headed upstairs, smothering their laughter at Malfoy's obvious rage and confusion. "Well, it's true," Harry chortled, as they reached the top of the marble staircase. If he hadn't stolen Neville's Rumbrel, I wouldn't be in the team." "So I suppose you think that's a reward for breaking the rules?" came an angry voice from just behind them. Hermione was stomping up the stairs, looking disapprovingly at the package in Harry's hand. "I thought you weren't speaking to us," said Harry. "Yes, don't stop now," said Ron. "It's doing us such good." Hermione marched away with her nose in the air. Harry had a lot of trouble keeping his mind on his lessons that day. It kept wandering up to the dormitory, where his new broomstick was lying under his bed, or straying after the Quidditch pitch, where he'd be learning to play that night. He bolted his dinner that evening without noticing that what he was eating, and then rushed upstairs with Ron to unwrap the Nimbus 2000 at last. "Wow," Ron sighed as the broomstick rolled into Harry's bedspread. Even Harry, who knew nothing about the different brooms, thought that it looked wonderful. Sleek and shiny with a mahogany handle, and it had a long tail of neat straight twigs, and Nimbus 2000 written in gold on the top. As 7 o'clock drew nearer, Harry left the castle and set off towards the Quidditch pitch in the dusk. He'd never been inside the stadium before. Hundreds of seats were raised in stands around the pitch so that the spectators were high enough to see what was going on. At either end of the pitch, there were three golden poles with hoops on the end. They reminded Harry of the little plastic sticks Muggle children blew bubbles through, except that they were 50 feet high. Too eager to fly again, to wait for wood, Harry mounted his broomstick. He kicked off from the ground. What a feeling! He swooped in and out of the goalpost and then sped up and down the pitch. The Nimbus 2000 turned wherever he wanted at the lightest of touch. Hey, Potter, come down. Oliver Wood had arrived. He was carrying a large wooden crate under his arm. Harry landed next to him. Very nice, said Wood, his eyes glinting. I can see what Professor McGonagall meant. You really are a natural. I'm just going to teach you the rules this evening. Then you'll be joining team practice 3 times a week. He opened the crate. Inside were 4 different sized balls. Right, said Wood. Now, Quidditch is easy enough to understand, even if it's not too easy to play. There are 7 players on each side. 3 of them are called chasers. 3 chasers, Harry repeated, as Wood took out a bright red ball about the size of a football. This ball is called the quaffle, said Wood. The chasers throw the quaffle to each other and try to get through one of those hoops to score a goal. 10 points every time the quaffle goes through one of those hoops. Follow me. The chasers throw the quaffle and put it through the hoops to score, Harry recited. So, that's sort of like basketball and broomsticks with 6 hoops, isn't it? What's basketball, said Wood curiously. Never mind, said Harry quickly. Now, there's another player on each side who's called the keeper. I'm the keeper for Gryffindor. I have to fly around our hoops and stop the other team from scoring. 3 chasers, 1 keeper, said Harry, who was determined to remember it all. And they play with a quaffle. Okay, got that. So, what are they for? He pointed at the 3 balls left inside the box. I'll show you now, said Wood. Take this. He handed Harry a small club, a bit like a rounder's bat. I'm going to show you what the bludgers do, Wood said. These 2 are the bludgers. He showed Harry 2 identical balls, jet black and slightly smaller than the red quaffle. Harry noticed that they seemed to be straining to escape the straps holding them inside the box. Stand back, Wood warned Harry. He bent down and freed one of the bludgers. At once the black ball rose high in the air and then pelted straight at Harry's face. Harry swung it with a bat to stop it breaking his nose and sent it zigzagging away into the air. It zoomed around their heads and then shot at Wood, who dived on top of it and managed to pin it to the ground. See? Wood panted, forcing the struggling bludger back into the crate and strapping it down safely. The bludgers rocket around, trying to knock players off their brooms. That's why you have 2 beaters on each team. The Weasley twins are ours. It's their job to protect their side from the bludgers and try and knock them towards the other team. So, think you've got all that? 3 chasers try and score with a quaffle. The keeper guards the goalpost. The beaters keep the bludgers away from their team, Harry reeled off. Very good, said Wood. Have bludgers ever killed anyone? Harry asked, hoping he sounded offhand. Never at Hogwarts. We've had a few broken jaws. But nothing worse than that. Now, the last member of the team is a seeker. That's you. And you don't have to worry about the quaffle or the bludgers. Unless they try to crack my head open. Don't worry, the Weasleys are more than a match for the bludgers. I mean, they're like a pair of human bludgers themselves. Wood reached into the crate, took out the 4th and last ball. Compared with the quaffle and the bludgers, it was tiny. About the size of a large walnut. It was bright gold and had little fluttering wings. This, said Wood, is the golden snitch. And it's the most important ball of the lot. It's very hard to catch because it's so fast and difficult to see. It's the seeker's job to catch it. You've got to weave in and out of the chasers, beaters, bludgers and quaffle to get it before the other team's seeker. Because whichever seeker catches it wins his team an extra 150 points. So they nearly always win. That's why seekers get fouled so much. A game of Quidditch only ends when the snitch is caught. So it can go on for ages. I think the record is 3 months. They had to keep bringing on substitutes so the players could get some sleep. Well, that's it. Any questions? Harry shook his head. He understood what he had to do, all right. It was doing it that was going to be the problem. We won't practice with a snitch yet, said Wood, carefully shutting it back inside the crate. It's too dark. We might lose it. Let's try you out with a few of these. He pulled a bag of ordinary golf balls out of his pocket, and a few minutes later, he and Harry were up in the air, Wood throwing the golf balls as hard as he could in every direction for Harry to catch. Harry didn't miss a single one, and Wood was delighted. After half an hour, night had really fallen, they couldn't carry on. That Quidditch World Cup will have our name on it this year, said Wood happily as they trudged back up to the castle. I wouldn't be surprised if you turn out to be better than Charlie Weasley, and he could have played for England if he hadn't gone off chasing dragons.